I was like, Dom, I'd love to get you to open for me on one of my dates. And he was like, hey, you know, nothing personal, kid, but I'm not an opener. I go, no, I know that. I'm doing these bigger shows and, you know, nah, thank you though. I appreciate that, but I'm a headliner. And I'm like, and then I knew he wasn't being a dick. I just knew he also didn't understand that I was about to do these 16,000 seat arenas.
Yo, Dom, over here. Hey, Dom, hey.
Yo, Dom.
Yeah. So we have the end of the world again here. They don't get a little rain, they get flooding and moons, everything's shining and broken down. But the 101. We should tell people what it's like here.
Wait, what do you mean the end of the world? What's the panic?
We have rain today.
God forbid for that in Los Angeles.
People bitch about it. It's a desert, you know. Fucking planet's raining again. It was raining. Remember this time last year, rain.
It's like snow. It's like snow on the East Coast.
Dom, tell them to come shovel my payment in February. They want to cry.
It's a shame how many guys get heart attacks. And they shovel snow. It's like you can't sit there for 2 years and then get up and start shoveling your neighbor's block.
It's gonna be Steve, bro.
And you, everybody says the same thing when they go to the doctor. You got to bend your knees. Make sure you're bending your knees, Grandpa.
How do you like that climate out there, Dom? Do you like the?
It's a Mediterranean climate. I'm very pleased with it. Yes, thank you.
So are we all in agreement that we no longer do an intro? We just wedge right in.
I think we should do the intro and the outro.
Oh, you do want an intro?
No, not now. It's too late.
But you want an ending.
It's too soon. It's too soon.
We should talk a little, I think.
Yeah, all right. I just want to be professional. That's the reputation I want. Professional and
then
funny.
Stop being yourself. What can I tell you?
What's going on your end, Dom? What's new out west?
Podcasts are all over the place. I gotta go to one here. I'm Padello. I'm watching football, man.
Football?
Yeah.
You're really into it this year?
I'm always into it. I mean, as long as the Eagles or Dolphins are playing.
Well, Eagles are number three. Sports line to win it all, which is crazy. It's Buffalo, Kansas City, Philadelphia Eagles. Put your money where your mouth is, Dom Irrera. Come on. No,
who knows
up.
Where that money's been? Pull it out of my ass.
Dom, I was doing a show in Philly, and there was a 19-year-old kid. I just thought about you bringing this up when we were talking about Kill Tony, and there was a 19-year-old kid that was on the show, and he goes, oh my God, you got a show with Dom Irrera? That's unbelievable. And I was like, yeah. I was like, how do you know Dom? Like, I'm just asking because he's 19. He goes, Kill Tony legend.
That's amazing.
19.
They have like some pamphlet or something that all the ones I've done. I had no idea it was that many.
Oh, you don't know how many you've done?
No, but they...
But I can find that out.
You could find that statistic right away.
Yeah, probably.
Dom, you did one last year in Texas, right?
Well, Rogan came back with him and who's the guy who takes his shirt off all the time?
Bert Kreischer.
He kicked him and Bert's drunk, Joe's drunk, and they just sat down and we laughed and all, but we didn't get anything done. Got like on a regular night.
I mean,
it's interesting to see what abuse people will take. You know?
Oh, but were you planned to do that show that day or you were?
I was doing a festival there. I stuck around because it's on Monday nights.
Well, that was the same festival you did. Are You Garbage, right?
Yeah.
Was that live audience or in a studio?
Yeah, it was fun. A lot of fun. So how many Tonys did I do?
I'm trying to find. I think I'm going to have to count them. One, two,
hurry up.
One, two, three, four.
While Brian's looking that up, Dom Irrera is back on the East Coast November 18th and the 19th. He's at the legendary governors. Is that Long Island or Staten Island, Dom or Eric? I forget.
It's Long Island. Plus, maybe it's a little late, but I had to cancel.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, don't
we're
be sorry.
We're going to have to cut that out. I'm sorry.
No, don't cut it out. Just I love those people. I wish I could have gone. I just couldn't go this time. It's one of my favorite groups because they're like Philadelphians, but without dealing with my family and friends. You know, no comps, no this bullshit.
So the comps don't stop. They're always going to ask for tickets.
My sister got so tired of it. She took an order of 40. Dom, can I get you some tickets? You know, what do you want? 4, 6, 40.
Somebody asked. They asked her for 40.
Yeah, because they didn't want to ask me. Who asked for 40? Then if they said, "All right, cut it to 20." You think, what a relief. 20.
What's the craziest thing somebody asked you for?
Could you get me a good seat? Could you give me? I don't want anything for free. I just want a good seat. I said, well, first of all, I don't organize my seats when I go to the club.
They think you're going to walk them and seat them.
Well, I said, do you see those guys? And there's women in tuxedos. The reason for it is they want tips because they're going to tip. You don't know the game at all.
I counted 30. 30 some odd episodes.
30 Kill Tonys. Wow.
Yeah. 30 some odd episodes.
Dom, how'd that all happen with you being a regular on the show? Kill Tony.
I don't know. I used to go upstairs to Don Barros. You know who he is?
Mm-mm.
He's a warm-up act, but he's also like a kind of a legendary. He always goes on last. And it's some kind of gook night, you know, like all the kind of semi-challenged people. And you go up, and I would do like a set as a lounge comedian. Is this thing on? Hello? Is this how's the work in here? Oh, you know. And I don't know, I got into this character and then it just morphed in back to me. And I like the idea of telling people the truth, you know.
No, I feel like some of it was exaggerated. Come on, you didn't mean to bully them guys too hard, did you? Like you would give credit when they did a good job in a minute, you would give them credit.
A minute. The guys would do 40 seconds and go, am I done yet? I see you can't stop writing, huh? Couldn't fill a minute. I mean, not for nothing, but you could do that.
You talking to me? I hope you're talking to me. I know, no. I could do a minute. I've done two. I've actually done 2 minutes on stage in Atlantic City is the most I've ever done.
What was your thing? What were you talking about?
I was actually going to be in a wedding, and the joke was about how, like, the best thing someone could do when you get married is to not invite your friends to the wedding, so they don't have to go, like, you know, pay for all the stuff and do all the the bullshit. That was it. I got a couple laughs, but then
I hate a couple laughs.
Yeah, then the next time I went on, just completely bombed.
You don't remember what you talked about?
No, that was pretty much it. It was only a minute or two that I was up there.
Was it like all jokes or?
Yeah, it was jokes. I was working.
How did you fill the time?
It was jokes. I had 2 full minutes of material that I went through.
Gave himself an encore. Here, I exit.
No, I was working for this comedy club, AC Jokes, in Atlantic City, and doing video work, and they just, you know, they put me up one night, and I kind of, you know, had fun with it.
You say you know you lot. You know that?
No.
You did like 20 you knows. Run it back.
See, this is what he does with Kill Tony, Brian. Brian was actually saying to me in a phone conversation this week that he wants to try to prepare a minute and try to get on Kill Tony as a new comic.
You could practice it with us.
I think that'd be fun. I think it'd be fun to go in front of those guys like that.
Dom, we can get him a killer 1 minute set, don't you think?
Yeah, definitely.
That would be a lot of fun, I think. That's like a bucket list thing. And you know, Brian Licata, Brian the video guy, our producer, he's a big, big, big Brian Redban fan for our listeners.
Yeah.
That's how he started this whole
I was there. I was at Joe's house and Brian came over talking about it. So amazing, a couple of years later to see what happened.
What's that, like getting into the podcasting?
Yeah, just the whole thing. Joe, I go over to Joe's house to shoot pool. He goes, you gotta check this out. You know, like the whole numbers. He goes, look at this, I got a million followers. What the fuck, you know? It was incredible. It was like a magic, you know?
Oh, so was Brian Redban, was he a comic, Dom? Or he was just a guy that like hung out, super fan of comedy?
He's just a guy that had no talent, like Brian here, you know. Like it's easier for them to focus.
It's more in the name, Brian, you know, that's really what it's about.
No, Redban's talented. I don't know what he's doing now, but I like him.
He's actually doing some virtual reality stuff.
He produces. He produces Joe Rogan Experience, right?
No, he's a different
guy. No more. He's not involved no more, but he is producing Kill Tony with Tony Hinchcliffe. He's still a big part of that. And I know he started The Secret Show in Texas. There's a comedy show called The Secret Show. Hmm. It's like a showcase for new talent. And like a lot of the headliners that are based in Texas, they'll pop through and they'll do drop-ins and they'll close it out. There's a lot of comedians in Texas right now, I think. I don't know if they're still there, but I know after COVID, a lot of LA comics, well, you know, they were based in Texas.
Well, Joe wanted it because his kids wanted it. And they're at the age you can move them, you know?
Yeah.
Not 13.
Well, what do you think of the comedy scene in Texas? You don't think it's strong, Dom?
Yeah, it's strong. I mean, you know, there's certain like they're like little islands of comedy. New York has one. Boston used to have it, but San Antonio, I mean, and Texas for sure. Austin, he knew what he was doing.
Yeah, and he's opening a club, isn't he?
He opened it. Yeah.
Oh, it's open already. It's in Austin.
Yeah.
I didn't know it opened. That's cool.
You know?
What's it like a 200, 300 seats?
Probably closer to 3. I guess Joe's probably there like 4 or 5 weeks a year. I don't know.
What's your, in your opinion, what's like your perfect scenario of a club? 50 seats, 150, 300?
The waitresses are whores. And everybody knows it. There's no shame to it. That will be tip. And if you want to get laid, 200.
It's a little something.
Have a nice day.
Speaking of comedy clubs, Dom, I've been seeing on Instagram and it's been popping up. You've been on a lot of the lineups at the Comedy Store and the Improv. You're back out there working out the scene. Any shows this week if anybody wants to come and check you out?
I'll be at the Comedy Store on Friday night. And then going all the way across town, 10 minutes to Improv. Improv is Saturday night too.
Those two clubs, two different crowds, or LA's really different. LA's LA.
No, and it's the Comedy Store is right across from all these hotels and restaurants. Mm. They get the tourists.
Right? Yeah.
Laugh Factory is collegiate, you know, and the Improv is kind of like hip Hollywood, you know, better looking girls, just better food.
More expensive, I'm sure. Maybe a little more expensive.
I don't know. I don't look at checks. I just, everything's 100. Duked them.
You gotcha.
Are we going to bring our guest in?
We're still Brian? Waiting for him to arrive.
All right.
Is he here?
Not yet. No, we're waiting.
No. We got a late bloomer this week.
No, he does. Is he here?
Not yet. No, he's not here yet.
I thought that was him.
No.
He's always late. He's always late for everything.
The secret's out this week. We're going to put that on. That's not getting edited out, Brian, by the way.
No, I think this is the first time that we had the beans spilled.
Hey, why did you want to do that?
What's you that? The surprise guest?
Uh-huh.
Well, I mean, we all had a meeting. We thought that was a good approach to this. What's your opinion on it?
He's one of the most famous money-making comedians in the world. He has followings like India and China. Can you imagine?
Wow.
That many. One show.
It's like 2/3 of the world's population.
Hey, is that you?
I do know some things, Dom. I may not be the funniest, but I am smart and handsome.
You think you're funnier than him?
Than our guest? I wouldn't say that. You know.
And, why are you trying to start trouble, Dom?
And now the guest.
He's an instigator over here.
The guest is has just arrived. We're just waiting for them to connect.
He's very goofy. Don't make fun of him.
Our guest this week is Russell Peters, everybody. Hello. Oh, how are you?
And he's got the smoking. Hey, look at that.
It's my youngest daughter, Dominic John Joseph Irrera.
What do you say there, tits? How you doing?
What's up there, Pally?
Where you been? I haven't seen you since you got married. Was that the best wedding ever?
Did you like it?
Oh, it was great.
I was worried about you there, you know.
Who was the guy that did the warm up, you know, he did it before you? Cedric, the entertainer.
Cedric, who married us, yeah.
He was terrific.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect.
Or no. Like, carry on.
That's easy enough, huh?
Yeah.
That you're going to get yourself dizzy blowing like that.
Hey, yo!
Oh, how's the wife?
She's great. She's in the house there.
Russell, you smoking outside or inside? I'm Steve, by the way. That's Brian.
Brian, the producer.
So you're from Philly. Steve's from Queens. Got it.
No. Actually, Brian's from Jersey. I'm from Philly.
No, well, you're wearing the right hat for Philly, and Jersey doesn't have a team, so he's got no choice.
It's Mets, Yankees, or Phillies, you know?
Yeah, really the or choices. They should have, like, a team for Jersey, like the toll booths or something, you know?
Yeah. I like the way you think.
Hey, ooh.
Where you been, man? I miss you.
I just got back from Europe.
Cha-ching.
Like a week ago. I was there for a month.
Europe? You go to Australia?
They didn't move it to Europe yet.
Are you doing geography jokes now?
Where the fuck do you think you're Australia? I'm pulling this fucking thing over.
Hey, calm down. I hate when he gets himself all wet like that.
No, I'm going to Australia in March next year.
You go back to Europe after that?
Only if they move Europe to Australia. We will be doing a second round of Europe next year. So you're not all wrong.
Can I close for you?
Would you?
Yeah, I'll go up there. That's it for Russell. What about me, hey guys? I'm from bada boom, bada boom.
Russell. Oh. How about the Rudy Roo man?
Rudy Roo. They were real
good, Dom.
What's that?
I said, how you been?
I've had better days. I got a broken back.
The fuck?
I can't run anymore. I can't jump and do my ballet lessons. I keep sliding to the floor.
You know, I warned you about that a long time ago.
How'd you guys become friends? I was trying to do my research here, and I didn't ask Dom. How'd you guys connect?
Well, we saw each other for a while in Montreal.
Yeah, we both remember it differently.
I know.
I remember it correctly.
Make me look like a bad guy.
Well, I remember it correctly. Well, Dom was already a big star when I met him. So when I met Dom, it was 1996. And Dom was fucking Dom Irrera. You know, I'm just some punk-looking kid who looks like this.
Oh, wow.
Look at that.
I like the pose.
My eyes are open a little.
Yeah, you became more Asian as you got older.
Hey, Dom, Russell gets the points with the suit jacket. I don't know.
I know.
I was 96. I was just a punk kid. You know, I didn't know nothing from nothing.
Was that at a club, Russ, or a festival?
At Just for Laughs in Montreal. I was 96, and I was so excited to meet him. I was like, oh, my God, Dom Irrera. Hey, kid, how you doing? And he had this really hot French girlfriend that he used to roll around with over there.
I gave her all my jizz.
I said, jizz, what's your problem?
She didn't get your money, just the jizz, Dom.
So
he's got neither left now.
Was I not nice to you?
You were always nice to me. What are you talking about? You were never an asshole.
Yeah, don't you hate that when they find out you're somebody all of a sudden they're nice? You said to me, you know, one of the first things you said to me, I'd like to bring you to open with me. I didn't know what he was talking about. You know, I was like, I don't know you. I'm going to open for you. But then I found out the kid was loaded with talent. So anyway, no,
you know what it was? And that's actually my fault when I did that. I assumed Dom knew, like, not so much who I was, but what I was doing and stuff. And this is like maybe around 2007 when I was starting to do arenas. I started doing arenas in 2007. So I was like, Dom, I'd love to get you to open for me on one of my dates. And he was like, hey, you know, nothing personal, kid, but I'm not an opener. I go, no, I know that. I'm doing these bigger shows and, you know, nah, thank you though. I appreciate that, but I'm a headliner. And I'm like, and then I knew he wasn't being a dick. I just knew he also didn't understand that I was about to do these 16,000 seat arenas.
It was weird though, because you hadn't hit in America yet. So they could put you in the Laugh Factory and it wouldn't be a big deal. But if they put you down with the bigger, where the Lakers play,
the Staples Center,
yeah, you start doing that, like something.
No, I started doing Microsoft, which was the Nokia Theater back then, but we would do two in a row, so it'd be like doing one Staples. Yeah, it's like 7,500 seats in there, so it's like two nights is one Staples.
So you were drawing overseas before you were in the States.
Yeah.
I started drawing in the States. That's what made me move here. Oh. And then, but it was like always in the bigger cities, you know.
Right.
Like I go anywhere in America and not fucking sell out. It's not a problem for me to go to Iowa and have like a Thursday night where there's 40 people and a Friday, you know, early show that's busy and late show that's not, you know, like that. That's just the nature of, you know, look at my demographic. They're not in fucking Iowa. You know, they may own Iowa. That's about it. You know, go and purchase and leave, you know.
So I got a fun story. My wife is born in Russia. And I've been a comic 10 years. Ugh. And she's and she's into comedy now, but a lot of the people I bring up, you know, she does her homework after I say it. And I said that you were going to be the guest on the podcast tonight with Dom. Mm-hmm. And she like instantaneously went crazy. She's from Russia. So it's like, she knew right. She was like, you got to be fucking kidding me. She went crazy.
Yeah, the international world knows me better, and I you know what? I'm better with that. I'm happy with that. Because everybody else can have America. Look at all the guys that have America. Chris, Dave, Sebastian, fucking Joe Coy, all these guys got America. Bill Burr, everybody owns America. And I'm like, they're all American. That's fine. They should have. It's their country. You know, but when I go to...
easy, big boy.
I just did Portugal. I just did Vienna. I just did, you know, Berlin. And then, you know, so I look at it like that. I'm doing Taipei, Taiwan next year. I'm doing, you know, in Hong Kong, Singapore, Bangkok. So I'm like, all right, well, you guys got this place. I'll take the rest. Thanks.
Did you ever start touring or did you ever start traveling before you started touring like that, like through Europe or Asia or anything like that?
Well, so what happened was I was doing England from 95. I started basing out of England in 95. I was already 6 years in. And then when you're in England, you end up getting like these weird gigs. It'll be like my little agent over there would be like, hey, Russ, do you want to do Belfast on Tuesday and Derry on Wednesday? And then you do Cork and Dublin on Thursday and Friday. And I'm like, yeah, sure.
It's like the whole country, right?
And you're doing that. Country. And all of a sudden it's like, hey, there's a gig in Brussels on a Wednesday. It's at an Irish pub in Brussels. I'm like, sure. And it's like, hey, do you want to go to Hong Kong? And I'm like, hell yeah. And you want to? I went to Dubai in 99 when there was only one hotel.
Wow.
So in the 90s.
That's crazy.
Are you doing clubs or theaters at these places?
You're doing clubs with like all expats and shit like that. And so when you're doing these places, it's not like you're really in these countries yet. But you're learning about, I mean, I'm learning about these countries as I'm there. And then I'm taking in all this knowledge and just retaining it and using it when I need to, you know. It's like anything. You don't use all your knowledge at once, you know. You use it as it comes up. And as it happened, I just started coming up and I started doing jokes about it. And then that's what made me cross over internationally.
Wow.
We were at the Laugh Factory in Long Beach. And some you were walking around and some girls said, you go, what's the matter? You go, She said, "You haven't done anything against Colombia." And she wanted, she wanted Colombia to be roasted. I've seen him, and it's amazing.
Yeah, I you would always get those weird requests. It'd be like, "Hey, I was waiting for some Latvian jokes." I'm like, "Oh yeah, Latvia. 20 minutes on Latvia. I don't know why I didn't do it."
Did you start?
I've done Latvia. I've done Lithuania. I've done all these weird places that you would never think of doing comedy in.
Did you start in Canada or in the States?
Yeah. Canada.
How was the scene in Toronto then?
Well, it was 89, so it was kind of like the end of the boom. Mm-hmm. You know, Dom was part of like so many golden eras. And Dom was like the head guy of the boom at that time. If you really think about it, Dom, you were kind of top dog in that world. And then it carried over. We got to, you know, you're one of the guys who, Dom's one of those guys who was around from when it was like the boom, as they said. And Dom is one of the guys who never ever got jaded about it.
That's because I forget easily.
And this is why your Alzheimer's is working in your advantage.
What were we talking about? Not like a good Alzheimer joke, huh?
I forgot to do one.
Hey, Russ, did you come to New York or L.A.? Which scene did you come to first in the States?
So, I remember going to New York in like 1991 or something. I'm 2 years in. I'm just doing like open mics and shit like that. I remember doing the New York Comedy Club with Tim Andre on the door. Remember him, Dom? Tim Andre?
I'm familiar, but I'm not sure.
And there was a guy named Rumpelmeyer, who was like this really gay dude who was like scary
really,
gay.
Really gay.
And you're like, damn, you know. And this is at a time where you were doing like, when you do gay jokes in like the early 90s, I remember doing gay jokes in the early 90s. I was saying, I'm saying faggot, like there's no tomorrow, like it's not an offensive thing or something. We had no clue like what we were doing was wrong or anything. We're just like, this is what we did, right? You might look at my old act, like stuff I said back then. And you ever look at some of your old stuff and you go, damn, I don't know what I was thinking then, buddy. Who was that guy?
It's gotten worse, yeah. I mean, you can't say... You and I, because we would do that thing from Blazing Saddles. Oh, yeah. The sheriff's a
yeah.
The remember that?
He would always, I would show up, most of my friends are black, and I would show up, and Dom would be like, who's with you? I go, I got a few of my...
It got really tight, man. I don't know. I think everybody should say it all the time. Water it out. There's got to be something done.
Yeah. Just everybody starts to become like complete, just go completely against everything and go back. We're taking it back to what? To 1985.
What's the other one? Cunt, huh? That would be. But except when you go to Ireland, you go to England, they all go, hey, that waitress is a fucking cunt.
It's well, Angelo, you know, Angelo's here, and he literally just did Ireland. And what did you just say that they said to you, Ange?
I said, how you doing, you fat cunt?
Angelo, how are you, brother?
Hey, man, how are you?
Good, man. Are you...
Brian said, say hello to Brian from the City Limits. And say, he actually said, say hi to Russell and to you. Said you've been there years ago.
Tell him I said hello.
Wow. That was like...
always working on material. Remember when we were in Australia, Angelo?
Yeah. Remember that we were at the Sydney Opera House?
What a dump that was, huh?
Well, I'll never forget what you said to me, Dom. You're like, comics don't appreciate those moments. And I was there with my wife and daughter, and it was Brian Paulson and Arj Barker and a few other guys. All the comics were sitting around bitching about how the Wi-Fi wasn't working. I'm like, we're playing the fucking Sydney Opera House.
I know. You had your daughter there. She was having a ball.
Yeah.
Oh, you did it too? I did it back in the day.
Yeah.
That was the first time I always have you a strong set, Angelo. Mostly you always struggle when I see you. Where'd he go?
He's over there.
Thanks, Dom.
I mean, come on, it's a joke. I love you, baby.
Oh man, I love you too, man. I can take it.
He knew he was laughing.
You know, I know you're laughing. We're laughing.
Jesus Christ, this is like watching fucking. Hey guys,
how long have you two been friends?
20, almost 30 years now.
Almost 30 years.
Jeez, isn't that weird?
Yeah, I thought he was going to die years ago, but I'm surprised he still got 2 feet. But
they're purple.
I mean, they're purple and they're swollen, but that's not the point. He does lose one. You ever see when they take an elephant's foot and they make it into an end table?
Where do you go from here, brother? You get here for a month or so?
No, I got to go to Florida this weekend. I'm doing the Hard Rock in Fort Lauderdale and the Hard Rock in Orlando Friday.
Oh, that's cool.
I seen you're in New Jersey next month, right?
Yeah. You coming to that?
NJ Pack. That's right near my house.
Well, look at that. Come on down, you son.
Cuz.
He'll totally forget you. Don't worry about it.
Just bring your Russian wife. I'll remember you then. Ah, Svetlana, what are you doing here?
I'm not allowed to laugh at that. You got to edit this, Brian. Stern face.
Svetlana, what are you doing here? Is she live and direct from Russia?
She was born in Uzbekistan.
Who's Uzbekistan?
I'm South Philly Italian, so we don't.
It doesn't mean you have an excuse.
Uzbekistan, and then she was living in Russia, and then she moved here when she was 20.
And she's 21 now, so that's
no,
great.
No, she's not.
She's 15 now.
We were just talking about 1991, you moving here, and we went into this crazy transition. I want to hear about the 90s and breaking into the New York comedy scene.
So I came here and I went to New York in 91, did a couple of sets, and I went back to Toronto. Because, mm-hmm. I'm an open micer. I don't know shit about shit. I didn't have a good set. I didn't have a bad set. I just had a whatever set, you know? And then I started going back to New York in 96 because Keith Robinson and Patrice O'Neill told me I could sleep on their couch.
Keith Robinson, Philly guy.
You bet your ass he is. Uh-huh. Sleep on my couch, jackass. And so I went over in 96, and I got spots all over the city then. Boston, Cellar.
Mm-hmm.
Stand Up New York. What's the other one? The Comic Strip. Did it everywhere. And then I remember Keith telling him, I got... This guy goes, hey, man, you want to do a spot? And it's in the Bronx. It pays $75. I'm like, hell yeah. It was at a place called the Bronx BBQ. And it was like 1:30 in the morning on a Saturday night on Fordham Road. Well, I got booed. It was a black room. And Keith is like, listen, stupid, even I don't do these fucking rooms. You're going to go there and get kicked in your fucking throat. And I kicked in my throat. It was good.
And how do you end up in L.A.? Was that by accident or was that planned?
I ended up in L.A. in 2006, like January 1st, 2006. I moved to L.A. I started getting heat from my third special, which was shot in 2003. It came out 2004. And by the end of 2004, I was getting all these bookings and making a buttload more money by November of 2004 than I was making in February. I'll give you an example. February 2004, I played DePaul University in Chicago. They paid me $700, and I was like, yo, that's a lot of money. At the time, I thought it was like, damn, that's a lot of money.
You're right.
And like 11 or 12 people showed up.
Damn.
And I felt bad. I almost wanted to give them money back, but I'm like, no, I need this money. But then something happens within that year. My special comes out. It starts getting file shared. And by November of 2004, I go back to Chicago and I sell out these three theaters for three nights in a row. And I'm making like 70 grand all of a sudden. I'm like, what the fuck is going on? Yeah. And I still don't understand what's happening. I'm just like, I don't understand the internet. I don't understand file sharing. I don't understand nothing. I don't know how it's getting out there. But all I know is that people are coming. People are wanting to take pictures. The money's there. And I'm like, this is great. Then YouTube starts in June of 2005.
Mm-hmm.
May or June of 2005, and then that was it. It was over, or rather, it started.
You got on YouTube like right away, I guess.
I had nothing to do with it. Somebody put me on there.
Oh, someone just started posting your stuff up.
Yeah. To this day, I don't know who did it.
Do you remember the bit? Do you remember the bit that you did?
It was my whole 2003 special.
Okay.
It was the one that came out in 2004. Yeah, it was the entirety of that special because clips of it had been sent around, and now the whole special had been sent around.
Remember the last time we did something there together, and we were fucking around so much, we kind of like looked like we didn't care.
We probably didn't. We probably didn't. Oh, didn't we do?
Jeremy had his dog there.
Yeah. But didn't you and I do the Borgata together one time?
I don't think so.
We did do a date together somewhere, sometime, one time.
Oh yeah, 100 of them at the Laugh Factory.
Oh no, the one time we Dom flew back from Tampa with us.
Oh, that was so cool of you.
Yeah, we did the theater arena there, and Dom did the club, and then Dom, I was like, Dom, you want to come home with us? He goes, oh, I'm not going to be done till such and such. I go, well, we'll wait for you. So we waited for him. We flew.
I can't believe he waited for me.
We brought him back on the jet with us.
It was great. Bottle of red.
Yeah.
Those were the days. Bobby Jewell. Remember Bobby Jewell?
It was Bobby Jewell.
He's the owner of the owner of Side Splitters.
I never played Side Splitters.
Oh, you never played? He had a toupee. It was so bad. It looked like a beret. You know, looked like he'd get drunk and it would tell it. But, you know,
put it on a gangster lean. Like, you know, he's like, hey, man. So, you know, had a good weekend, guys.
But you know, I never wanted to ask him this. Doesn't he know that we all know?
It's always funny with guys with toupees, no matter how bad it is, and they're still rocking it. You're like, nobody's gonna tell this guy that this is the worst fucking thing we've ever seen.
I had a boss like that.
You never said nothing to him?
Never. No, it's your boss. What are you gonna say?
Yeah, you should say, boss. When is this free or do I have toupee? You know,
my buddy hated his guts. He said, you got to go up to him and go, your hair looks fabulous today. He said, I was like, you got no fucking shot.
I remember there was this car wash by my house in Toronto, and it was these Sri Lankan dudes that ran it. And the guy, his toupee was actually really good. I had no clue he was wearing one. So one day he said something. I went, I went to touch his hair. Like, just like, and he like stopped my hand in the air and is like, hey. Then I started noticing, oh fuck, he's got a wig on, but it was a good one. I didn't even know.
I feel you don't see much of those anymore.
No, well, you're a hairy immigrant looking guy. What's your fucking deal?
Well, I'm a mutt. I'm a couple things, Italian mostly, but
well, you can only be two.
No, my mom's Irish and Danish, and my dad's Italian and Polish.
So he's not from Italy, right?
No, he's not. No,
he's not from Poland, right?
No,
your mom's not from Ireland, right?
That's true.
I guess your mom's not from Denmark, right? I don't know. You're fucking what you are.
He's a mutt.
A mutt. A good looking kid. A good looking strapping young man.
Yeah, you look like a fucking Iranian kid.
It was actually right after 9/11. I was like, you know, probably 10 or 11, and I got patted down for 4 or 5 years after that. Family vacations, going to Florida, and everything.
I'm more impressed that you're only 10 or 11 when 9/11. Oh, you got any other fucking kids you want to have on this podcast?
So did you feature at all, Russ? Are you?
Oh yeah, I was on the road, dude. I was a road guy the whole time.
Wow.
I was doing every fucking little shitty club I could do a spot in. I think one of the last really bad gigs I did with Angelo. It was in Oshawa, Ontario in Canada, and it was a club called Excuses. It wasn't even a comedy club. It was just like a bar that did a comedy night. What was that, 2004? It was about 2004. And I fucking bombed that night. And some lady got kicked out for being drunk, and she called me the N-word on her way out. And I was like, get the race right at least, stupid. You know what I mean? She was a big fatso, and she was terrible. She was wasted, probably drunk on Bailey's. I don't know what, you know.
I was working at Yale. They had a comedy club there. Mm-hmm. And I said something about Italians, and this lady comes up to me. She goes, I don't like I don't like you talking about Jews that way. I said, what are you talking about? And she got fucking crazy on me. And he said, I'm thinking, what are you, a fucking nut? And she said, well, you shouldn't make fun of the Italians like that. I said, I'm Italian. She goes, oh, I thought you were Jewish. He goes, she goes, oh, okay. Give me like the go ahead to say Jewish. I don't know. You ever get people who are so out of it that you go, what the fuck planet are you from?
I still say my favorite line of yours is, I got a problem.
I said,
yeah, you know, I got a problem. I can't say Jew.
What a bastard. Jew bastard. I think, I don't know, maybe I'm too idealistic, but I'd like to see us all get along better, period. Mm. You know, not Rodney King it, but Jesus, what the fuck? Remember when you could say all that shit and comedy clubs didn't matter?
I think we should still say that stuff. That's the only way to defeat the slave dragon. If we start fucking tapping now, you're going to, you know, I do jujitsu. It's like tapping when a guy doesn't have you in an armbar. Why? Why'd you tap? I don't know. I got tired.
Mm-hmm. Russell, that video went viral. You beating that dude up in the drawer. Jesus Christ, bro.
I just had him in an armbar. That's all. I put him in a
little How long ago? That was a while ago, right?
That was 3 years ago.
Did you have security with you when that happened?
No.
Damn, bro.
There were bouncers in the club.
I had a wrist lock and an arm lock on him, so he was done either way. I would have snapped his wrist and his arm.
I gotta take lessons, man. The security in comedy clubs suck.
Oh, I know. That's why I'm always like, people are like, are you ever afraid? I go, fuck no. I'm bringing it on, motherfucker.
Somebody comes up there,
I know what I'm doing, and I know what you're not going to do.
You used to box, right?
Yeah, 9 years.
Damn.
Well, you think you could take him?
No, not me. Absolutely not. You see this video? Brian, can you bring that video up? Bro, he fucking took this dude's a big dude too.
Oh, dude,
he got him, and you escorted him to the door. Like you literally manhandled this guy. He had to weigh like 250 easy.
No, when I grabbed him, I was like, "Fuck, this guy's strong as shit." When I grabbed his arm, I was like, "This dude's strong as shit." I was like, "If I don't get this, he's gonna fuck me up." That's exactly what my brain was doing. My brain goes, "You better get this, or he's gonna fucking destroy you."
See, that's funny because if I fight a guy that's bigger than me, I want to get him off his feet.
Yeah, I'm good with it. Better off.
See, maybe that's a rookie move or just being an Italian from the city. That's stupid.
How often do you get in physical competition?
Not many, Dom. Right. But I don't think Russell does either. No disrespect, Russ. I know he used to fight.
I did a lot of fighting growing up.
Oh, really?
I got into a lot of fights growing up. And, you know, at 52 years old, sadly, I still won't shy away from
one. No, you dig it.
I'm still like, what'd you say? Come here. Let me talk to you. My security guys know when we're on the road, if somebody's being a dick, because I don't yell. I don't raise my voice. I don't lose my temper. They'll look over and they'll see me do this. Because I'll do this. They'll be over there and I'll go. The minute they see the smile, they fucking come running because I'm about to fuck this person up. Because I smile at you right before I do something. I'm like, wow, that's cute. We were in Lebanon. Some guy said something. I went, pop right in his liver, and he went and I go, well, don't talk to me like that. You don't fucking know me like that. You're gonna start talking to me like I'm an asshole. I'm trying to be respectful, and this guy's like, well, you look like a cocky motherfucker, and I'm like, oh no, that's not how we're talking to me today, kid.
Can I ask Russell Peters opinion on the Will Smith Chris Rock thing?
Sure.
What's your thoughts on that whole situation?
My thought is that Chris thought Will was coming up to do something funny, you know, like, hey, off my wife, you know, like, right. I think that's what Chris thought Will was doing, because Will's known for being a little wacky like that, right? You know, a little shticky almost. And then Will slapped Chris. And I still think that Chris thought Will was messing around and miscalculated the distance.
Mm-hmm. He handled it well, didn't he?
Right. That's why Chris didn't freak out right away. And then Will went and sat down. It wasn't until Will started swearing at him that Chris realized he was angry.
Chris has been dangling it the whole time. Now he won't, he's going to do something someday about it, but what a fucking asshole. Not Chris, Will. He's a Philly guy. I was ashamed of him.
Yeah, and then like this weird wave is happening now. I know there was a club in Jersey. Some dude threw a beer at a female comic.
At a girl. Yeah.
Out of control. Great.
She drank it too, right?
Yeah.
She drinks the beer and then she did a spot on Kimmel two weeks later.
Amazing,
man. That, like, the guy who did that needed his ass beat. Like, if I was there, I would have fucking beat the shit out of him.
That's what I'm saying. Like, that's the fucking shit that's going on now. Like, if anything, I feel like clubs and theaters should open their eyes and try to protect the performers more. Don't you think? Or it'll never happen.
No, they better. Otherwise, they're going to look. What's going to happen is you're not going to get the good comics in anymore because they're going to be like, I'm not taking a chance on your shitty club.
It's crazy.
Like, you know, and a lot of guys is like, you know, you want to make money, spend some on security.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of the good clubs have like good security. Like Levity has like retired cops and shit on hand. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like the one in West Nyack.
Dom, have you ever seen any physical altercations at a club? Like with the headline?
So fast, you know. Like when we talk about a fight, you're talking mostly 30 to 60 seconds. That's it.
Right. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know? It's never, you know, like in the Westerns, you got a bunch of guys, like, shake it off.
It
never happens. Wait, are you done? Okay, let's go.
Yeah, I never seen a knockdown dragout. You're like, what is this? Because if it's a knockdown dragout, you're like, wow, you guys really don't know how to fight. Because this shit should have been over within 2 seconds.
I got the video up over here.
Let's see this.
You guys want to watch it?
Uh-oh. What are you, rocking a Yankee fitted, Russ?
Maybe, probably. I might have been, yeah. So this guy's about to walk out of the store, and then I'm like standing right there, and I'm like, all right. And then he takes a swing at my friend's father, and that's when I go, come here, get the fuck over here. And then this guy jumps in.
Damn,
bro. What are you doing? I got this guy. Leave him alone. Let me get him. I know what I'm doing. And then they're trying to scuffle, and I'm like, just leave it alone. And then I'm trying to get his arm. I'm like, he tries to get to the door, and I give him a slap, and he hit his head on the side of the door. And then they're like trying to mess up. I'm like, you see me trying to get his arm? I'm like, just a guy, step back. Let me get this fucking arm. And they're trying to hold. I go, give me the, let me take his arm. You're blocking the arm from me right now.
Oh, yeah.
Get the arm right there. And as soon as I get the arm, I get him down. I crank the wrist up. And then when you can't see, I kick his arm out from underneath him. So he falls. So he's off balance.
Jesus Christ.
Did he try to tap it all?
As soon as I locked his arm, he goes, okay.
Really? He said that? Oh, man.
Okay.
But did he rob you?
No, he was trying to rob the store of a ring. The ring was $250,000.
Good for you.
But it's my friend's store.
Way to step up.
It's my friend's store. And the other thing is, I wasn't going to get involved because I'm like, well, it's not my store. Right. But when he took a swing at my friend's father, I was like, nah, that's not going to happen around me, kid.
Yeah, not going to fly.
Yeah.
This was in the, was this in the Diamond District in the city? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Yeah. Did you ever see that the Adam Sandler movie about the Diamond District? I can't remember.
That movie Uncut Gems. Awesome.
Yeah.
That movie should have got an Oscar nomination.
100%. 100% agreed. It's called Uncut Gems. He has like a gambling debt, I think, was the plot of the story. And
it's about a bunch of Jewish guys that weren't circumcised. Uncut Gems.
That was a big theme in the movie also. Yeah.
It's one guy that they always talk about fighting, especially South Philly, you know. I threw him through a fucking wall. I said, you talk about fighting a lot. When's the last time you were in a fight? He goes, I don't know, second grade?
And it was a cardboard wall.
Right. It was Tom, Dom, I'm your Philly friend that's not confrontational at all, by the way. I'm not confrontational. Now, my dad and my uncles, they're hard-headed. They're idiots. Me, I want to talk it out with you. You know,
how old are you?
I'm 36.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you're from a different time.
Yeah, but I don't jump right to a physical. I want to have a discussion. Like,
well, you know,
why are we making this decision? This could lead into a bad direction. You know, our generation, to talk about it first.
Our generation never thought about lawsuits or suing or none of that. So yeah, just like,
that's true.
My father and my uncles, they're 56.
Oh, there you go. Well, you're dead. They're my age. So you call Dom Grandpa, or what do you call him?
Yeah. I
call Dom the goat.
Dom is the goat.
Philly for a Philly Italian comic, Dom Irrera is.
I think just for a comic, Dom's
in general. This is
You know what I like about me? It's funny you would bring it up. Down to earth. You ever notice that? He's down to earth, even though he's better, stronger than a lot of these guys.
And very humble. I mean, his humility is something else.
Proud of humility. You know who said that? Benjamin Franklin. He said, I'm proud of my humility. He was a clever man. Lived right down the street from me. I love you for coming to the same
high school.
You know, when he was inventing things.
Ross, thanks again for doing the podcast, man. Yeah,
it means a lot to me. I appreciate it.
You know, Dominic John Joseph Irrera, I love you more than you'll ever fucking know.
Oh, I know.
And in December, I don't know, you always take off in December, but I'm back from December 13th, and I think we need another dinner.
Definitely.
Last time we had dinner, it was your birthday.
What was that? Oh, the sushi place where we brought Mike Ivey?
Yeah, yeah.
You get it, my friend of mine, Mike Ivey, he's a black man from Mississippi. He's got his accent's hilarious. You know what? He calls me Nickopedia because he thinks I know everything. Well, Nick, according to Nickopedia. But isn't his fucking accent hilarious? Whatever that is.
Deep, like a deep southern voice.
Well, no, he's you'll see him in a lot of commercials because he's got a good character face. He's got like a really white afro, and he's an old guy. So the fact that he still has all his hair is impressive. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's all I got for you. You know, Dom, I was wondering if you knew where my ink pan was.
He don't. He said that when I taught fourth grade, the kids, Mr. Irrera, Thomas Grayson stole my ink pan. Remember Hollywood Shuffle? Did you ever see that?
Of course. You guys never saw Hollywood Shuffle?
I've never seen that.
Oh my God, Dom's a fucking beast in that movie.
No, I gotta check it out. No, I've never seen it.
It's pretty Dom funny. Was awesome in that movie.
Look it up, Brian.
Yeah.
We'll for our listeners.
It. Yeah, we'll have to watch it.
Come on, Brian. You could watch that and braid your arm hair at the same time. You'll have a great day.
That's our show. Yo, Dom, Russell Peters, thank you again a million times.
Thanks, guys.
Anytime for Dominic.
Thank you, Russell.
My friend.
See you guys.
Yo, Dom, over here.
Bye.
Hey, Dom.
Hey.
Yo, Dom.